And there's kind of lessons and wisdom in that for everybody's business, no matter what you're doing or what your farm strategy is. So that's why we wanted to highlight it and call it the Startup Farmer. So I'm going to turn it over to them, but I just want to say a couple things about everybody on the panel. Sitting next to me is Andrew Fansler. Has a tremendous story. He is a true startup farmer. He literally started from no land as a teenager to now managing thousands of acres in central Indiana, and has approached his business extremely creatively, very deliberately since being a teenager. Jamie Walter is here from Illinois, and Jamie has built one of only two distilleries that are on farm in the United States, called Whiskey Acres. So using the unique aspects of his acres and his crop and the crops he was able to raise and knowledge of the distilling industry, he's actually built his own whiskey business. So extremely creative and has some kind of astonishing numbers about what that does to the value of your crop. Next to Dean is Matt Jaeger from Minneola, Kansas. Matt and his brothers have built a whole bioproduct business around the farm with both recycling and actually getting into farm adjuvants based on bioproducts that they've built also based on unique aspects of their farm. And last, not least, is Dean Folkvord from Wheat, Montana. Dean created Wheat, Montana 26 years ago based on his family's wheat farm in Three Forks, Montana. And it's turned it into, what started with just finding a way to mill their flour, then moved up into baking, and then actually moved into a full retail restaurant chain throughout or in Montana, with the bread products with national distribution, with distribution through Walmart. So has really moved all the way up the value chain from the farm all the way to the restaurant in some cases. So with that, I'd like everyone to take a few minutes and just introduce yourself, tell us about your businesses and how you created them and kind of what led you there.
Okay. I'm Andrew Fansler. I'm from Shelbyville, Indiana, which is just southeast of Indianapolis. And I farm about 5,000 acres of corn and soybeans. We grow white corn and yellow corn, and also grow seed beans for Pioneer. The story of my farm is a little unique. I am a first-generation farmer, and I did start when I was 14 years old. I had the opportunity to rent 42 acres and trade labor for machinery with a neighbor, and just kind of got the ball rolling from there. And I get asked a lot, what got you started? What was something that happened or, anything? And, the response I give people is, when I was 2 years old, the only thing I wanted for my third birthday was a pedal tractor. And I was a city kid, but that was the only thing I wanted, the only thing I talked about. And fortunately for me, I got that pedal tractor and still have it today. And it's kind of a really important part for me, for my history, it kind of takes me back to my roots and helps me understand that this is not something that was in the family, no multi-generational deal, and have had absolutely zero help from my family in achieving this goal. Now, the later years here in life, I've gotten support from my family, but early on, zero support at all. So that's kind of who I am and where I got started, and I'm sure we'll get into more of it soon.
Yeah, it's a really great story. I'm glad we could pass this down to Dean. And so with that, we can introduce Jamie Walter.
Good afternoon. My name is Jamie Walter. I'm with Integrated Farms, which is our farming enterprise, and Whiskey Acres Distilling Company. We're located about 60 miles due west of Chicago in Dekalb, Illinois. You've probably heard of Dekalb before, the birthplace of hybrid seed corn. I actually came back to the family farming operation as the fifth generation farmer almost 20 years ago now. I'm actually a recovering attorney by trade. And left the practice to join my father when I had an uncle that retired and there was enough room on the farm. So joined an already very successful farming operation that had been put together by, you know, the generations before me, so I really rode their coattails to success in the farming end of things. But when I came back, the thing that my father and I sat down and talked a lot about was, you know, where are we going to head in the future? And we looked to diversify our operations away from just being strictly a commodity producer. During kind of the boom times of ag, we really sat down and strategized about where we wanted to head and the model that we wanted to look at, decided to reinvest some of our profits into a value-added enterprise and take advantage of our proximity to Chicago. And so we started a whiskey distillery. So we're only the second certified farm distillery in the U.S. There are some other farmers that do a little bit of distilling on the side, but, you know, it's a federally regulated industry. Getting the permits and the licenses to start was a big deal, but once we started production, the sky's been the limit. So we're very proud of the quality of products that we make using all entirely our own grain. So we grow corn, soybeans, but we don't use that in the distillery. We're still very much a commodity farm as well, but we raise corn, wheat, and rye for use in the distillery, make bourbon, 100% corn vodka, and a rye whiskey are our primary product.
Unfortunately, due to licensing, we couldn't get Jamie's whiskey at the event.
We tried. Currently, we're distributed just in the state of Illinois. We're in about 300 and some locations. As we have more inventory that is aged and is ready to go, we'll be expanding our distribution across the U.S. But we couldn't get it done for Nebraska in a short period of time. So.
Well, you got something to work on. All right. Matt.
Yep. Thanks for having us up here, Charles. This is my first FBN conference, and, you know, there's been a lot of, I think FBN's trying to, you know, show that they can do some things and some outrageous things to a certain extent, but the most outrageous thing I think that happened today was that a farmer got up in front of 1,000 farmers and said he watches the Kardashians. That's bold right there. My brother Luke and I, who's here, we operate it's about a 7,000 acre dry land farm in southwest Kansas, and have a cow herd, and then a couple other businesses, and that's kind of what they're talking about, startup farmer. So coming out of college, I guess it was 2000 I graduated, but kind of those mid 90s, 2000 times were not the greatest, you know, on the farm. And I had two older brothers that's all they wanted to do was farm. And so it took about everything Dad could do to get my brothers going. Luke took over my maternal grandparents' farm, and my brother was farming with my uncle. And, you know, the times weren't just great, so I actually moved to California and worked doing mission work with high school kids and coaching football and stuff like that. In 2007, I was kind of tired of the city and wanted to move back, and so my brother Luke kind of threw me a bone and said, I've been around this biodiesel stuff, we had to look at it. And so we started crunching numbers on a business plan, and I said, man, this sounds really fun. You know, when I was, you know, growing up, you would have never thought that the farmers could participate in the energy side of the country. And so we have a small, we started in 2007, a small biodiesel plant, kind of a niche plant. We produce less than 1 million gallons a year. And then as kind of things developed with farmers, we really like to research a lot. And as we say, we're Google-trained chemists. So we started a spray advent company as well. And it was kind of really my only way to kind of get back on the farm was to provide some other income in a side business. And it's been fun working with them.
Great. All right, Dean, go for it.
Thanks for having me here all the way from Montana. I know there's a good contingency of Montanans around here, so shout out to all my Montana buddies. I'm pretty impressed with FBN so far. You know, we need some disruptors in ag. We need an Uber in ag, and I think these guys might have something here, so I think we need to encourage these guys. I really like the vibe around here and the young people. And young people interested in agriculture, it all can't be bad, and pretty smart guys, it looks like to me. So I think the best is yet to come. We're kind of disruptors, but not in ag, really, even though ag is where our heart is. Even though we've got a pretty cool company and a lot of things going on, farming is really what I get off on still and what I really like to do. What we're kind of disruptive, actually, in the in the retail and wholesale flour market, and we've been disruptive in the fresh and frozen bread market. And so it's kind of neat to be a part of that, because our competitors really can't tell the story that we have and you all have, because we have a farm. You know, the big bakeries and the big flour mills, they don't have farms. They don't want to get back into the food chain. There's too much risk, too much uncertainty for them. And so that's why I think that we have a shot. So I just put a few slides together just to kind of illustrate some of the things that we do up there. I'll try to go pretty fast. I am jealous of the guy sitting up here, though, that makes whiskey. You know, we take grains and we make bread, a product that actually deteriorates with age. And he takes grains and makes whiskey. It gets better every day that's on the planet. So we really screwed up our business plan. This is where we farm. Coincidentally, you could shoot a bow and arrow right to the headwaters of the Missouri River, which flows right by here, surprisingly. So the three rivers that make up the Missouri, the Madison, Jefferson, Gallatin, all converge just below those grain bins there. And that's one of the things. Every one of these slides I included has a marketing message, and so that's why I included them here. So we can talk a little bit about that, because that's what really makes it work for us. And we talk about all this stuff to our customers. So we're right at the headwaters of Missouri, and there's mountains in the background. People really get off on that. We also are a conservation farm. We put the whole farm into a conservation easement. That's something that we talk about to our customers, because they want to know what we're doing in terms of sustainability and, you know, what we're doing to make the land last longer. So these are the kinds of things we like to talk about. We are no-tillers, too, and people like to know that we're not killing up the soil, it's not blowing away, and that we're getting more with less, and we're conserving moisture. We're using these stripper headers on our combines, and many of you guys might be familiar if you're into wheat and small grains, but we're in very dry country there. We're 12.5 inches of rainfall where we live, and we've had a couple of pretty dry years, so we've been struggling on yield, but the stripper headers are really making it come together for us. We can cut a lot faster, we can do a lot more. I was telling some guys this morning, we used to have 6 combines on the farm, we now can cut it all with 2, because the stripper headers let us go about 8 in pretty good wheat, so we can roll right along. So this is another slide that talks a little bit about, I thought it was pretty significant because we're at high elevation in a lot of our farms, fields. Now, these are not the biggest fields that we have. We do have some fields that are over 1,000 acres, but this one's not, obviously, because it's kind of up on the top of a mountain almost. But a lot of our farms are above 5,000 feet. And so if the high elevation, cool nights, the arid climate that takes what we grow, which is not high quantities of wheat, but we grow really high quality wheat, you know, we typically harvest our spring wheat, you know, in the 15-16 protein range, and our winter wheat in the 13-14 protein range. And those are the kinds of things that we want to talk about, you know, with our customers. We try to be pretty modern in most of the things that we do. We don't like to talk about chemicals and things, although you can see tram lines in the field there, but we're trying to implement all the things that the Europeans and all the good operators do so that we can do more with less. And again, those are things that people want to, talk about. We got elk in the field in this particular picture. We're all out cutting the elk are out in the middle of the field. It's another thing that people get kind of jacked up about, because they like to know that we're coexisting well with wildlife. And, you know, these are the kinds of conversations that we like to have with our customers, because they want to know that we're doing the right things on our farm. This is where we actually process all of the grain. It's only 5 miles from the farm. So we started out hoping that we could use everything on the farm that we produced. The farm's gotten bigger, but we have a lot of contract farmers. We buy a lot of grain from a lot of people. We thought we used to have to do it all ourselves. That's one message that I would send out to anybody that's thinking of value added in any way. You don't have to do everything all yourself. We don't grow flax, and we sell an enormous amount of flax, both ground and whole of flax. And we sell a lot of chia seed, which is unbelievable. I thought chia was, you know, for a chia pet, but now we eat a lot of the stuff. But that grain bin there in Delhi, that's the mothership store, and that is where we actually provide the full experience for our customers. They know we have a farm. They know that the grain is being processed, cleaned, and flour milled in the back, and there's a bakery back there that produces the bread. And, you know, I was growing up, there were cheese factories in every small farm and creamery, or in every small town, and creameries in every small town, and they were all become extinct. But there's definitely a movement back to try and figure out where all this stuff comes from, and people like to know where their food is grown. So this is just a picture of some of the marketing that we do. We like to drive home the concept of the field to table. and some of the products in the background. And we also like to make sure people know that we're family friendly. You know, we're all GMO free on our farm, obviously. We are because wheat's non-GMO, but a lot of people don't know that. We try to talk about all those things and try to help educate them in the right direction, although we can't be the educators. This is where kind of the rubber hits the road for us. You know, we've got flour in a reclosable pouch bag. That's what's made our products most popular on the shelf, and that's why we've disrupted that space a little bit. And then the breads and the other things that we do, we just try to maintain really high quality. Clean label, not a lot of things that you can't pronounce on the label. We've gone all GMO in all of our breads, not because we think that's awesome or anything, but our customers certainly do, and we try to provide a pretty wide spectrum of products.
Great. Well, I think, you know, what's so unique is everybody's business came from a different place, from a different origin, and as we got to, you know, sort of talking and sharing, and everyone was sharing ideas about, you know, where their business came from, everybody had to make at a certain point a decision that they were going to change their farm strategy or that they were, you know, going in the entry case, launch a farm strategy. And, you know, there's a thought process that everybody goes through when you decide to start and do something new. I think it's what's also really important about the ways in which you've gone about it is everybody was pretty deliberate about thinking through how you created your business. And so one thing I'd like to ask about is, what was it like when you first created the business? What led you to that decision to do it? And then how did you start the process of getting going? How did you actually decide to take the leap, do the planning, and get going? And if I'd like to start with Andrew.
All right. So mine was pretty simple. You know, I was a kid that had a dream. You know, every one of us in this room at some point was a kid and had some great dream that we were going to be a basketball player, a football player, something. Well, you know, sports was kind of easy to me. There was no challenge in sports, and the challenge was being a farmer, and so that's where I set my sights. And some of the things that I guess when I look back and to see what were some of the obstacles, what were some of the risks, I had a guy say something to me one day about, you know, wow, it's just so impressive that you're a first-generation farmer, and you've been able to grow this operation. And something I told him was he was a fifth-generation farmer, and I said, no, what's impressive is you're a fifth-generation farmer because you have all the baggage. You have all the ancestors that farm. You have the farm name. You have the reputation you have to uphold. You have the family farm you can lose. You have all these things that are going against you. A lot of people say, well, that's all the support and help you need. But to me, it was all the baggage that you're dragging down the road, trying to every decision you make, you have to think about the history and what decisions you make today. What does that do for tomorrow? With me, I had no risk. It didn't matter. If I failed, I failed. If, you know, I succeeded, I succeeded. I wasn't going to damage anything except myself. And a lot of people, I think, saw that as a major weakness. If you're not in this industry, you can't succeed in this industry because you don't know how to. Well, it's not whether you can or can't succeed in an industry. It's whether you're willing to put in the time and the effort and, you know, the preparation to make it happen. Something I touched on after I got going, I was in college in a business writing class, and one of the things we had to do was make up a fictitious business, and we had to write a marketing plan on it. So my idea was, I'm going to put a marketing plan together for Fansler Farms. And, you know, I really got into it because, you know, it was a dream I had, and, you know, at this point, I'm already farming a couple hundred acres, and also I wanted to get an A in the class. So I get done with this whole process, and, you know, I'm like, you know, I've really worked hard on this. I think it's really good. You know, why don't I try to use it? Let's just see if I can, you know, implement what I've actually put together for a class. And the success I got from that project was incredible in, you know, helping the growth of the farm and helping me also understand how important a business strategy was moving forward as we grew.
So you actually, you know, really putting in the time to think about it, going through the thought process, you know, suddenly it actually starts becoming real,
yeah.
You know, in your mind as you get going. Jamie, you also did something, you know, very similar when you started. You really sat down and kind of decided to take a step to the farm.
Yeah, as I mentioned in my introduction, you know, my father and I had this interest in doing something value-added in the farm for some time, but it was really during the agricultural boom that we really took a hard look at our farming operation, and I sat down and did a SWOT analysis, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats, and really took a hard look at our operation. And one of the things that, you know, we felt, for those of you that are familiar with our area, Dekalb is 60 miles due west of Chicago. Chicago obviously can't expand to the east because of Lake Michigan. So as development moves out, it gets closer and closer to us on our doorstep. We are not big landowners. It's a choice we made many generations ago. Most of our farmland is cash rented. And between the 1031 exchanges, exchange money, and the desire by a lot of farmers to get bigger, competition was fierce for land. So fierce that the price we felt that was being paid either to purchase land or to rent it was not sustainable and really didn't offer us a lot of opportunities for success. And so because of that proximity to Chicago, that was a real threat to us. We really wondered what was going to happen. But at the same time, that same proximity to Chicago created an opportunity in that, you know, it's the third largest metro center in the U.S., and they're right on our doorstep. And there's this growing interest by consumers to make these linkages to the farm and to get closer to their producers. And so as they came closer to us, well, hell, let's get closer to them. And so it was a real opportunity for us to capitalize on creating a consumer product that could turn things on its head a little bit and allow us to succeed. And so when we made that decision, kind of in that 2012 range, we decided to take the excess profits, if you will, from farming and plow those back into a related business that I think, you know, time will tell, but it seems to have been a pretty good decision.
Yeah. And Matt, when you came back to the farm, you guys got started in biodiesel, but that's quickly expanded into a whole lot of other areas. How kind of the business evolved as you guys have gone through it? You know, starting from biodiesel being a direct product that can be processed from the farm, but then actually turning that into many constituent products and services that you've expanded into.
Yeah, it has. It's just kind of amazing. It even surprises us sometimes what's happened. And I think Amal talked about, giving somebody a job, and that was something I'd never done before. And I was just hoping to make enough money, make this thing go to benefit the farm. We didn't, we couldn't get funding early on, so it was a bootstrapping business. You just fund it out of our existing. So my brother and I started doing a bunch of custom harvesting and trying to generate extra cash to throw at the business. And by the way, I think that's a great way to start a business is not rely on a bunch of funding up front. We had to figure out how to make money from day one and make it go. I think how it's changed, giving somebody a job was one of the coolest experiences, I think, for me. And now we're in a town of like 800 people, and we got 12, 15 full-time employees and maybe as many as 30 part-time. We actually are adjuvants. We kind of made a decision as part of our brand. We bring the, there's not a lot of jobs for kids in small towns anymore, small farm towns. There's not the farms don't need much labor, and, there's not a lot of opportunities. So we, at this point, we're able to, bring a bunch of high school kids out, and they jug all of our adjuvants, and put them in the pallets to get shipped all over kind of a five-state region right now. So that's been fun to see it grow and evolve that way, and just something an enjoyment, I guess, that we didn't foresee out of that. But, our goal was, I say I needed a job. I mean, I didn't want to be too dependent and cost anybody any money. So I needed a job, and we wanted to preserve, the farm and grow the farm a little bit. And our dad had a lot of rented ground. He'd rented for years and years, and he lost some of that ground. So part of our motivation is to try to gain some ownership in some of the ground. And as you all are well aware, that's a steep climb and farming these days. So it's, you know, a little bit of that. And it's, honestly, Luke was like, it's costing me $1,000 to fill my semi with fuel. And when fuel prices are really high. So let's do something about that, you know, on our farm. Okay, chemical costs, let's do, you know, let's figure out things to try to help our farm control input costs. So that's a lot of our motivation, too.
You started by solving your own needs, you know. You started by solving your own needs, and that turned into much bigger opportunity.
Yeah, and, you know, one of the weird things we do, I think my picture there, I'm by a pumper trailer, so we pump oil from all these, used cooking oil from these restaurants, about 400 different restaurants, and that was kind of a humbling deal. So it's the grease wars, it's dumpster diving. But the first thing we do when we go to a restaurant, we drive out back and see who the rendering company is. So we're a small rendering company in that oil space as well, and it's a weird business, but it kind of ties in with the farm somehow.
And Dean, you guys had you've been going for 26 years. What was it like when getting wheat Montana started? You know, what was the kind of transition from, you know, being a wheat producer to then, you know, moving gradually up the value chain? How did you guys get into it?
Yeah, it's kind of an interesting story. I guess I've told this story hundreds of times, but you know, it was a time when we had just gotten married. We were pretty young. We hadn't traveled much, you know, and I'd moved back to the farm, and we were just doing that. And we had gone to Hawaii, and I'd never been to Hawaii. I really didn't want to go to Hawaii, but my wife wanted to go to Hawaii awful bad. So we were a young couple, and we ended up on the island of Maui. And we went to this place where they gave tours of this pineapple plantation. And it was a pretty idyllic scene because up behind the factory, there was these fields where they grew pineapples. And you guys may have been there, Lahaina, when they do that. And then they had a factory where they were processing pineapples. And they were bringing them in the back, and they showed you where they were doing that. And they were getting them set up, and then they were cutting them up and making wedges out of them. They were doing all kinds of stuff in the back. And then out in the front, they had this little shop where you could actually purchase their product. And they were giving you pineapple drinks. You could box pineapples and send them all over the world. And, I mean, the place was packed with people, and they were having a heck of a day in there. And the place was called Pineapple Hawaii. And I looked at Hope and I go, God, I wonder if we could do that with wheat and call it Wheat Montana. Well, that was the end of the trip. There's an escort from that point forward. And we came home with the idea, and my folks were open to the idea. It kind of spawned this thing that we've had in our family now for 25 years. We developed a saying that when you dream alone, it's only a dream. So Hope and I, when we came back from Hawaii, we had that little dream, and we were thinking, you know, that we could actually take the wheat, some of the wheat, and we could do like a roadside stand where we actually ground flour and people could drive by and buy a bag of flour. I mean, that was initially kind of the idea. And we started into that and got an order from a health food store, and we didn't have no idea how we were going to clean that wheat up and get it turned into flour. So we built a small cleaner and put it in the bunkhouse of the farm, and we cleaned up our first bags, and then we had a little grinder that we made, and we took an old mandrel iron into the shop. Mandrel is one of the spawns, and we attached the flour grinder onto that, and that's how we made our first, you know, bags of flour. So we started sharing the dream with my folks. We started sharing the dream with a couple of people that we hired early on in the company. And, you know, the dream started evolving, and it continues to evolve, and it's not all milk and cookies. I'm not here to tell you that this is all fun stuff. But, you know, you can live your life out in some way. Everybody's going to live their life out, and so we're fortunate to be able to look back on a lot of tough times, a lot of good times, where we've actually made a significant impact in our community. You know, I was talking to somebody out there today, and they were worried about getting too big in their community in terms of being a farmer. He said, you know, we're sort of sucking lifeblood out of the community because we're becoming the big farmer, and I don't want to be the 800-pound gorilla. But, you know, I think that we all have ways that we can give back to our community. I mean, we all worry about that in rural America because towns are getting smaller. But if we are more and more successful, we have that duty then to give back, and we have the duty to participate in our community. And I think that that is a message that we all have to embody. These guys up here are already doing it in some ways, and I know a lot of you are as well, but the more successful we are, the more we have to do. And so We do it in a variety of ways with 200 plus employees. We have another business in our small town of 2,000 people that employs 50 people. And, you know, you can be the local hero, whether you want that or not. You know, when you employ that many people in a small town, it's a pretty big deal. And we try to focus and concentrate our resources in that small town. You know, we're close to the university, and it's built out, and we start employing people from all over. And, you know, these are not jobs that are just entry-level jobs. A lot of these people make damn good money. So it can evolve in a lot of different ways, and it can be very, very rewarding beyond the kind of, you know, financial returns that you get.
Well, you know, Brian Scott is a farmer speaking later in the afternoon. I was telling you a story last night. He said he was on a vacation, and he went to a duck pond. And at the duck pond, they were selling corn for a dollar a bag, and each bag was a pound. Said, $1 a pound, $56 a bushel. Said, I'll bring you 50,000 pounds tomorrow. You know, I've got an endless semi, you know, full of corn if I could sell it for $56 a bushel. What each of you have done in different ways is actually, you know, moved up the value chain, and you found different ways to find higher value from the crop you've been producing. Jamie, you've got a great story about this in terms of with I think it's just astonishing. So if you complain about 350 corn, you got to hear this.
When we started the distillery, you know, obviously we were trying to add value to the grain that we produce. And I'd be the first to tell you before you get too excited about it. The issue for us is throughput. So there are state laws in Illinois that cap the amount of alcohol we can produce within a given year. Right now we're producing about, in layman's terms, about 70,000-75,000 bottles a year. In order to do that, that takes less than 5% of the acreage that we farm. So the vast majority of what we grow still goes through normal commodity channels. But to Charles's point, the grain that we're able to run through the distillery, it takes roughly 3 pounds of grain to make a bottle of bourbon. That bottle of bourbon then retails for around $40. So our growth on a bushel of corn runs just about between $600 and $700 a bushel. That's pretty good. I just need to figure out ways to get more corn through that distillery. So that's been eye-opening for us, we're continuing the expansion mode at the distillery as the state raises their limits. We're putting more and more stuff away. The trick for us is a distillery, and farmers, I think, can appreciate this. You know, as farmers, we grow a crop, we put it in storage. You know, the inventory aspect of generating cash flow from your labors is a long one. It's even worse than distilling because we not only produce the crop, pull it out of the bin the next year, mill it up, distill it, then we lock it back up in a barrel for as many as 5 years. So we're talking about a long lead time, but that also creates a bit of a moat around our business, and it keeps other people from just jumping in because you've got to be able to weather some lean times in the meantime. We got to quit our day jobs.
$600 a bushel. It's pretty astonishing, but it's not that easy. It's not that easy, and it's not there's not that much grain that can grow through the system. But you know, it's also one of the big challenges I think that you know each of you face is that there's a giant difference between producing commodities and then building a brand, and that each of you have had to build brands around farms and brands around your product. I'd open this up to anyone who wants to, you know, comment about that because it's such a different world to trying to build a consumer product versus producing commodities.
Part of our brand, you know, especially with our spread, this is we're farmers first, and our products need to work on our farm, and we want to bring good value to the products that way, and so that is a big part of who we are. One of the largest, we were at a crop consultant meeting the other day, and you know, one of the largest retailers in the country called us a fly-by-night company, and we kind of went, yeah, you know, prodding them a little bit, and you know, I was like, yeah, we fly at night because we're working, you know. I mean, and that's just kind of our ethos, I guess. And we, you know, we want to farming is really what we enjoy and what we want to be about. We have some other things that we do, and so that's. But I think, you know, you farming is sort of a grounding for us, the work and the difficulties that farming is. We never really want to lose sight of that, even if we do other businesses, because it's sort of what we grew up doing, it's what we really appreciate and what we respect, in other farmers.
Yeah, it's such a mindset shift for most farmers. You know, those of us that are producing commodities haven't really ever had to worry about branding, making those consumer connections, and you know, we're so science-based that we oftentimes overlook the opportunities to make the emotional connection with consumers. And so for a farmer to shift from strictly commodity into some sort of a value-added or branded product, you have to shift your whole mentality. And, you know, it's hard. It's not easy to do, and producers, I would say, as a general rule, tend to not like to take the limelight. And when you're building a brand, you have to actively sit up here on a stage and promote it, you know, and that's not always easy to do. And there's another thing, too, besides the branding that I think is a big mindset shift for farmers. As a rule, farmers tend to be an independent lot. You know, we've probably grew up in an environment where, by golly, you know, you do things yourselves, you figure it out. And that can be a very good thing, but at a certain point, we all have to realize what our limitations are, what our strengths, what our weaknesses are, and focus on our core competencies. And sometimes, if you're going to do something different, you may have to get some help. And that's a different mindset, too, for producers to go out and actively seek, you know, other professionals, consultants, et cetera, to help you get established in a new area. And so that's a change.
It is. Well, even like with me, you know, I'm not producing a product for the direct consumer, but that was still the same approach I took in building the farm was, let's build a brand, and let's do something different, and, you know, as far as business marketing, let's get out and let's let people know who we are and what we're doing and what we stand for, and, you know, one of the things that we started with was transparency. If you want to see what your farm's doing, we're going to tell you. You know, if you had $1 million in the bank, you would expect somebody to give you a financial report, you know, monthly, quarterly, yearly, on what that money's doing. And that was my theory, is I want you to know what your land's doing every year, and I want you to see everything that's happening. So that was really a big, I think, thing in our community to help us with our branding side of it.
And it's all about kind of the story of your farm as well, and everybody's kind of talked about that in different ways, and Dean, you talked about it in terms of the land and, you know, the connecting the agricultural practices back up, and, one other question would be, how have the unique aspects of your farm influenced the decisions of the business you decided to create, you know, whether that was the quality of the grain or land access or those different pieces?
Well, I know with me, you know, something I haven't mentioned is when I was in college, I wasn't sure how I was going to support my farming habits, so I decided to get into the real estate world and had some, obviously, formal training, licensing, and things like that, and I had a kind of a key part of my life was I had an opportunity to go work for a huge commercial real estate company in I thought real hard and actually turned it down. But what that helped me learn was if I can be really good at real estate and I can focus on agriculture, land, in the real estate world, I can utilize those skills and those connections and I can bring them back to my farm. And now we're not going to be able to buy land cheaper than the next guy because we know about it, but we're not going to be able to, you know, rent every farm we sell or anything like that. But what it did was it put me in the know of what was going on in our local land market on a daily basis. And to where a lot of farmers get so engulfed with the job they're doing, they forget to keep their eyes and ears open as to what's going on around them. And so I think that was something that was a big benefit.
For us, identifying an opportunity of being a disruptor was a big one. And it's one of the reasons I appreciate FDN so much. But for us in the distilling world, how many people here drink whiskey? All right? So whiskey's generally, bourbon in particular, is made from number 2 yellow dense corn. Now, we all know as producers that there's a lot of different varieties of number 2 yellow dense, right? A lot of different characteristics of the grain from one plant, one variety to the next. Would it surprise you to know that there are certain characteristics, number two yellow death, that affect flavor? You know, when you think about it, probably not. In the wine industry, we take that as gospel. A Chardonnay grape is going to produce a very different flavor from a Cabernet Sauvignon. But in the corn and whiskey business, all of our commodity is all commingled. And then it's sold to very large industrial producers of alcohol, like a Jim Beam or a Maker's Mark, and it's all commingled. Imagine making wine, if you would, that had all the grapes mixed together, and you made wine out of it. It tastes like wine, but it's going to taste pretty much the same from this manufacturer to this manufacturer.
It's called two-buck chuck.
In our case, you know, we have a background in this genetics business, and we could identify some certain characteristics, certain markers of some of the genetics that we felt would lead us to producing a better flavored whiskey. And we keep those varieties pretty near and dear to our heart and how we identify them. But from the get-go, the very first products we made have all been major international award winners. And so we feel like it's a disruptive piece of information that the rest of the industry doesn't yet have and enables us to capitalize on an opportunity.
And Jamie, you were also talking about how even though you can't put 100% of your acres through your distillery and capture all the value, that having that extra acreage actually gives you a lot of insurance on your crop because you know that you're going to have, if one field is not producing or is not producing at the right
variety,
you've got the redundancy.
Right. It's part of our marketing story as well, is that because we use such a small percentage of the grain in the distillery, we tell our consumers that, you know, we save the best 5% for ourselves and we sell everything else to everybody else. You know, and it allows us to really create a premium, not only a premium product, but a premium marketing message. That's pretty key.
So one last thing I wanted to ask before, you know, opening up to questions. That one kind of theme is that each of you turned an aspect of the farm that was, in some cases, a weakness, or, you know, in Andrew's case, not having a farm background, just wanting to get into it, but that actually was a complete advantage because you could think completely differently and make decisions on a different time scale. I would just open this up. What would you say to people, you know, who are either they're thinking of opening up a business within the farm, which is already hard enough, or, you know, adding an extra business, or just changing the practice in the farm as to how you identify or turn those weaknesses into strengths? And if anyone had, you know, any story to share on that, I think that's such a cool theme about everything you've done.
Well, I guess if we went on the road, I'll just start in on that. But, you know, we were we're a high elevation, low rainfall area. I mean, we're basically trying to do it in the desert. I mean, we still fallow part of our farm. So that's how archaic our production systems are, because we only get 12 and a half inches of rainfall or of moisture. That's not rainfall. A lot of that's snow, and that doesn't get used. So, you know, we had to take the idea that we were growing high-quality grain versus all the other guys that were able to grow quantities of grain. And, you know, that was probably our most unique attribute from the get-go. The farm-to-market story was something we've been doing for 25 years, so now everybody's doing that. So I guess you have to find out what your strengths are and really capitalize on those things. We were able to do farm-to-market when nobody else was doing it. Now it seems like there's a lot of effort in that direction, and so we continually try to innovate. We were the first ones to put flour in a reclosable pouch bag, first ones in the country that we know of. And we got some traction right away with some pretty big retailers like Costco and Albertsons and Walmart. And now we're in every Walmart store. And it's not because of the quality of the product, which is good in those bags, but it's because of the packaging that got us the shot with those guys. Now it's not real high volume, or it's high volume but low margin business. And we're still trying to figure that out as we go through this process, but we were distributing in the western part of the U.S. and it's worked out pretty good, and we figured out the transportation. Now, when you cross the whole country, you start to have to figure out the transportation. It gets pretty challenging. So those are the kinds of things that you have to come up against when you start to have that kind of success. We're continually, though, trying to innovate and stay ahead of everybody, because now they're doing flour in pouch bags, so everybody's doing it. So we've gone on the non-GMO bandwagon, again, not because we really believe that's necessary, but our customers believe that. We have to give them what they want, you know, not what we want them to have. So another strength that we're able to do, and it's just like what Jamie was saying, if we're able to collect those varietals of grain and not commingle them, we have something separate and something special. And I think that there's some pretty cool traction to get out there right now by being farm or a company that's able to do that, because the big companies are unable to do that just because of the way they source all their commodities. So if you can pick a certain variety with certain attributes, and we're starting to figure out how to do that, and we're getting some pretty good interest. Now, heirloom seems to be pretty cool. I mean, we bought in tomatoes years ago, and now all of a sudden it's starting to poke into other parts of the market. And heirloom wheat is pretty hot right now, and so we're excited about that. It means that we have to take a step back in terms of production and probably grow a variety of grain that's not agronomically as hot as the new stuff, but we can get twice the price for it. And if we condition it in some way and clean it and package it, then we can get 3 or 4 times or maybe 5 or even 10 times what the normal wheat would be worth. So those are the kinds of things that we're trying to do. And if we can sort of steer ourselves in that direction, I think our company continues to have life for a long, long time. Otherwise, we become just like everybody else out there, and pretty soon all the products are generic again. So we got to make damn sure that we're staying out in front of the herd, or else a company our size competing with a company of, you know, ADM or General Mills or whatever size, I mean, they're going to just run over you so fast you'll never even get your head back up, above water. So we're trying to mimic the wine industry right now in our operation and try to figure out what varietals produce certain kinds of bread, certain flavor characteristics, and if we can identify that, I think that we can have a good run again.
Well, and I think this is a big new frontier of the whole industry, which is just using data to provide traceability. And that traceability, whether you decide to go into value add and you want to be able to tell the story all the way to the consumer, or it's just in the identity of the grain and being able to capture a little more value by selling a premium product, is really changing really fast. And there's just so many more people who want to be able to do that with producers. Before we run out of time, I did want to just see if there's any questions from the audience for any of the panelists. Paul is running around with a microphone, or if anyone had a question to ask, don't feel shy. But see anybody? Okay. If not, I have one more. Okay, running a farm is hard enough. running two businesses, is incredibly difficult. Startups aren't for everybody, and it's not that you have to start a new company to be entrepreneurial. If you could have, thought about your farm differently or expanded, into farm services where you have Andrew. What would you say to people who are considering it in terms of, taking a leap or not taking a leap, or the lifestyle? I would open that up to anybody.
I would encourage you. I didn't get hardly any encouragement when I was young, and I think I would encourage anybody to, obviously you've got to understand the risk, but at the same time, understand the potential rewards. And if you stay focused on it and you do your due diligence, I think the sky's the limit with anything you want to try. I think the one thing that I always say holds people back the most is the person that they look at in the mirror every morning. So, if you can break through that, go for it.
I would say know your core competencies. In our case, we knew we were excellent farmers. We produced a very high-quality grain. At one time, we were one of the major suppliers of corn to Sapporo beer. They were willing to pay a premium to come, halfway around the globe to buy our corn because they felt it made a better product in their beer. And so, those things combined with that genetics knowledge, that was a way for us to focus in on a core competency and take advantage of it. Don't stray too far.
Yeah.
You know where you're rooted, and go from there.
Yeah, and tying in your other question, I think, my brother, he worked for a couple years for another farmer. And then I did something different for a while, just kind of had to. There wasn't a real immediate opportunity. And I think if we evaluate those, we feel like we learned how to handle employees from being employed. And so, some of those things that, we weren't able to get maybe right for what we wanted to, but as we look back, I think the things we learned, from some of those other things we did, sales is certainly something that, I think you're talking to me, we don't being a farmer, you really don't like to do sales that much, and you don't like to be in the spotlight and things like that. But you kind of understand that to make a business go, you got to be able to do some of those things. And I think having to do some other job helped. And I think Andy talked about learning some things from his other job that way. So I think, you know, that was a benefit to have to do some other things as well.
Right. Well, any last comments from anyone, or any final closing words? Okay. Well, I just want to take a time to thank you all for coming, because it's really, you know, just so awesome about the FBN network and the thousands of producers that make it up, how many entrepreneurs and really creative businesses are out there, and that many of you are probably running as well. I was glad to be able to meet all of you. I'm sure there are many, many more of you out there, and so I hope that you all introduce yourselves to them, and if you're stopping through their neighborhoods, try out their products that you're building, and drop by the farm. And I just want to thank you.